Hello, welcome to live telecast on KU Band. I am Satish Kumar, lecturer in civil engineering, working at Adilabad. Today's topic, gravity dams, part 1. Headlines: headworks, types, reservoirs, types of reservoirs, selection of site for reservoir, site investigations, estimation of reservoir capacity from contour plan, different types of storages and definitions, estimation of yield from a reservoir, evaporation, factors affecting evaporation, evaporation losses. Let us see headworks definition. A hydraulic structure which supplies water to the off-taking canal is called a headwork. Headworks may be divided into two types: diversion headworks, storage headworks. Diversion headworks, examples: temporary bunds, permanent weirs and barrages. See this picture. See, this is the body wall of the weir constructed across the river, raising the water level on the upstream side. You can see here a small pool of water is formed here and excess water is flowing downstream side, and canal is constructed on the upstream side to the right side or to the left side of the weir. See another picture of weir. This is the body wall of the weir which is constructed across the river, raising the water level on the upstream side. Small pool of water is formed here. So canal is taken from the upstream side on the right of it or left of it, and this raised water level supplies the required quantity of water to the canal. Next, see this picture, barrage. Now this is the barrage. Barrage consists of gates. These gates raise the water level on the upstream side. During the floods, excess water is allowed to flow downstream side by lifting the gates. Canals are constructed on the upstream side of barrage, either left side or right side, and the raised water level by closing the gates will provide the required quantity of water to the canals. Next is storage headworks. Storage headworks consists of construction of dam across a river. Due to construction of dam across the river, a large pool of water called reservoir is formed. So let us see the example. Storage headworks. Example is dams and reservoir. Now see this picture. Now this is the dam constructed across the river, and you can see on the upstream side a large pool of water is formed. This is called the reservoir. See another picture. This is the dam across the river. Now this is a large pool of water which is called a reservoir. Now here you can see two pictures. One is weir, another is dam and reservoir kept side by side. Weir is small in height and it stores small quantity of water for small duration, and excess water is allowed to flow downstream side. In case of dam and reservoir, the height is more, stores large quantity of water for long duration, and this water can be used for many purposes. So this is the difference between this diversion head work and storage head work. In today's class we discuss about reservoirs. The dam part is covered in the coming two classes. Depending upon the purpose served, reservoirs may be classified as storage reservoir, flood protection reservoir, distribution reservoir, multipurpose reservoir. Let us discuss one by one. Storage reservoir. As the name indicates, storage reservoir stores excess water in the river, and this stored water may be used for any purpose. See, storage reservoir. Storage reservoirs are primarily used for water supplies for irrigation, hydroelectric generation, domestic and industrial supplies. The next one is flood control reservoir. Rivers overflow banks during floods. Flood control reservoir stores excess water flowing during the floods and releases it safely to the downstream side. Flood control reservoir is basically constructed to protect the downstream from floods. Flood protection reservoirs are those which store water during flood and release it gradually at a safe rate when the flood reduces. See this picture. This is a dam and reservoir which is constructed to control the floods. Here on the upstream side, the water is stored and the excess water is released to the downstream side safely by lifting the gates. By the provision of artificial storage during the floods, flood damage downstream reduced. Now here I define the term hydrograph. Hydrograph is a graph showing the variation of discharge with time. Let us understand the flood moderation by flood control reservoir with the help of a hydrograph. Hydrograph moderated by reservoir. On the x axis time is plotted, on the y axis discharge is plotted. The curve A, B, C is a natural hydrograph at the dam side before construction of dam with discharge Q1. By the construction of dam across the river, this is moderated and is shown by dashed curve. This is A, this is B dash and C. This hatched portion represents the water stored in the reservoir, and this dotted portion represents the water released downstream at a later time. That means by construction of dam, we store the discharge or excess water for considerable time and release the same to the downstream safely without affecting the downstream area. So by construction of flood control reservoir, you can see here the discharge is reduced from Q1 to Q2. So this is how the reservoir helps in moderating the flood at the dam site. The next one is distribution reservoir. A distribution reservoir is a small storage reservoir used for water supply in a city. A distribution reservoir accounts for the varying rate of water during the day. Examples are Himayat Sagar and Singur, which are basically meant for supplying water to Hyderabad city. So, it is a small storage reservoir. This point you have to keep it in mind. When compared to other reservoirs, the capacity is very small. The next one is multipurpose reservoir. A multipurpose reservoir is that which serves more than one purpose. Example is Damodar Valley project. This Damodar Valley project covers three states: Bihar, West Bengal, Jharkhand. So you can imagine the size of the activities included under this. The activities include flood control, irrigation, water supply for industrial and domestic use, power generation. Now, after discussing types of reservoirs, let us see the factors or points to be kept in mind while selecting site for a reservoir. Selection of site for a reservoir. The storage capacity of the reservoir should be sufficient to the requirement as per design. The meaning of this is the site where the reservoir is proposed should have sufficient storage capacity to meet the requirement as per the design. The depth of water in the basin should be more. If the depth of water is more, then evaporation losses will be less. Suitable dam site should exist. Look at this picture. Here, hills are situated on either side of the river, which is an ideal place for location of dam, because the dam can be anchored to the sites. Second thing is, the length will be less. The reservoir basin should have narrow opening in the valley. Now look at this picture. Here the width of the river is very small. This reduces the cost of construction of dam. The minimum valuable land should be submerged in the basin of the reservoir. If the submergence area consists of forest and other habitant lands, then there is every chance for not getting clearance for the proposed project. So we should always keep one point, that the submergence area should be less. The next, the geological conditions at the site should permit minimum percolation losses with maximum runoff. Percolation losses should be less, otherwise the water stored will be seeping into the subsurface, resulting in loss of stored water. Runoff, as you know, runoff is the discharge entering into the river. Runoff should be maximum. For this, the number of tributaries joining the river on the upstream side of dam location should be more, so that runoff will be more. The site should be such that a deep reservoir is formed. Now see here, this is the reservoir on the upstream side of the dam. This is the dam. Now here, the depth of the reservoir is more. If the depth of the reservoir is more and surface area is less, evaporation losses can be kept minimum. it should avoid or exclude water from tributaries which carry a high percentage of silt in water. If silt entering from the tributaries is more, then over a period of time the storage capacity of the dam is reduced. So, to avoid or to avoid this particular feature, the tributaries which are carrying more silt should be avoided, or proper measures should be taken to control the entry of silt into the reservoir. The water stored in it is suitable for the purpose for which the project is undertaken. Next point, the soil and rock mass at site must not contain any objectionable minerals and salts. After selecting two or three alternative sites for the reservoir, then necessary investigations are to be carried out to finalize the site for the reservoir. So, for final selection of reservoir, certain investigations are to be carried out. Following are the investigations for the reservoir: engineering surveys, geological investigations, hydrological investigations. Let us see one by one. Engineering surveys. The area at dam site is surveyed in detail and a contour plan is prepared. What is contour plan? Contour plan is a plan showing the contours of the area. Then what is contour? Contour means it is a line joining points of equal elevation. Now let us see a typical contour plan of proposed dam site or reservoir site. Now you can see here in this, you have series of contours. This is 100 contour, like that you have 150 contours. Now this hatched area shows the area of storage by the reservoir, and this is the dam site, and the amount of water stored depends upon the height of the dam, and this is the boundary of reservoir shown by dotted lines. This is also called watershed line. Now, from the contour plan, you can calculate the volume of storage. Now, see here, two pictures are side by side. These pictures are here to understand the contour. This is the water surface elevation. You can see arrows are pointing towards the periphery of the water surface elevation, which gives you a contour at this particular elevation. In this picture also, you can see the arrows are pointing towards the periphery of the water surface elevation. So, this gives you a contour at particular elevation. So, at different elevations, you will get a series of contours which form a contour plan of this area. I think you understand or get the visual understanding of a contour line. The next, from the contour plan, the following physical characteristics are prepared: area elevation curve, storage elevation curve, map indicating the land property to be surveyed, suitable site selection for the dam. From area elevation curve, you can get area or surface area at different elevations. From storage elevation curve, we get the volume of water stored at different elevations. And at different elevations, what is the submergence area, that is also to be surveyed. Then you should have a location for the dam. Now look at the elevation area and elevation volume curves. On the x axis, volume in hectare meters is shown. On y-axis, elevation in terms of meters is shown, and the area is also shown on x-axis in the opposite direction of volume. Now, this is the volume elevation curve and this is the elevation area curve. Now, you can see here the dotted line representing the maximum operating level. For maximum operating level, see this line is cutting your area curve at this point, and if you draw a line onto area, you will get the corresponding area. Similarly, if this line is extended onto volume and a vertical line is drawn onto the volume x-axis, then you will get the corresponding volume, and here you see the minimum operating level. The reservoir capacity or the volume of storage corresponding to a given water level in the reservoir may be calculated either by trapezoidal or prismoidal formula. So, all of you are aware of these two formula. Let us see the formula. Trapezoidal formula is V is equal to H into A 1 plus A 2 by 2 plus A 2 plus A 3 plus A n minus 1. Now, here H means contour interval, A 1, A 2 area corresponding to a contour line. Prismoidal formula, V is equal to H by 3 into A 1 plus A n plus 4 times A 2 plus A 4 plus 2 times A 3 plus A 5. So, 4 times even, 2 times odd contours. A n means area of the contour corresponding to water surface elevation in the proposed reservoir. This area can be obtained from the contour plan by means of planimeter. Planimeter is an instrument used for calculating, for obtaining area from, for an irregular shaped boundary. After engineering surveys, the next one is geological investigations. Water tightness of reservoir basin, suitability of foundations for the dam, geological and structural features such as folds, faults, fissures, etc. of the rock basin. If the proposed location consists of folds, faults or fissures, there is every chance of earthquake occurring in the future. So, such areas must be clearly studied before selecting for final location. Type and depth of overburden. Overburden means, the meaning of it is, generally any dam is founded on a solid rock, and this solid rock is at a considerable depth below the general ground level of that particular area. So, the depth of the soil covering the foundation is called overburden. So, if the overburden is more, the cost of construction will be more. Location of permeable and soluble rocks, if any. Groundwater conditions in the region. Location of quarry sites for materials required for the dam construction and quantities available from them. For construction of dam, you require large quantity of materials from for the dam. So, you must find suitable sites from where you can get the material. So, these places from where the materials are obtained, they are called quarries. So, quarry sites must be located and their quality must be checked. The next one is hydrological investigations. Study of runoff pattern at the proposed dam site to determine the storage capacity corresponding to a given demand. Now here the term runoff, as you know, is the discharge, that water draining into the river, that is called runoff. So this runoff pattern at the proposed location must be studied, and the storage capacity of that site must be calculated or estimated corresponding to the demand. So this we study in detail by use of mass inflow curve few minutes later. Now next, this is determination of the hydrograph of the worst flood to determine the spillway capacity and design. Now hydrograph is a graph showing the variation of discharge with time. During the floods, the discharge in the river is maximum, and it is not possible to hold the entire water in the reservoir. So there must be sufficient spillway for allowing the water to flow downstream side. So you must calculate the capacity of the spillway. So that also we discuss a few minutes later. The next, the entire depth of the storage is divided into different storages. Zones of storage in a reservoir: useful storage, surcharge storage, dead storage, and valley storage. Now look at this picture. Here you can see different zones of storage in a reservoir. This is the bed of the stream or river, and this is the dam, and this is the gate, and this is the sluice way to draw water from the reservoir. Now this is the normal pool level, this is normal pool level, and this is the maximum pool level, and this is minimum pool level. Minimum pool level is at the bottom of the sluice, whereas normal pool level is at the top of crest level. Now you can see dead storage. Dead storage is in between minimum pool level and the stream bed. This is the dead storage. This storage is not available for any purpose. And then you can see your valley storage in between these dotted lines, which is showing the level of the banks of river before construction of dam. So in between bottom of the stream bed and the banks of the river is called valley storage. Then between minimum pool level and surcharge and this normal pool level is called useful storage and is used to meet the various demands. And in between normal pool level and the maximum pool level is called surcharge storage, which is available during floods. Now let us see the definition of all these storages one by one. Useful storage: the volume of water stored between the normal pool level and the minimum pool level is known as the useful storage. Dead storage: the volume of water below the minimum pool level is known as the dead storage. Surcharge storage: the volume of water stored between the normal pool level and the maximum level corresponding to a given flood is called surcharge storage. Valley storage: the quantity of water stored within the banks of the stream is normally known as valley storage. The next, let us define the term yield. Yield is the quantity of water that can be supplied from the reservoir in a specified interval of time. safe yield or firm yield. The maximum quantity of water that can be assured during a critical dry period is known as the safe yield or firm yield. Then secondary yield. Secondary yield is the quantity of water available in excess of safe yield during periods of high flood. Then let us see the average yield. The arithmetic average of the safe and the secondary yield over a long period of time is called average yield. Mass inflow curve. A mass inflow curve is a plot between the cumulative inflow in the reservoir with time. This mass inflow curve is obtained from flood hydrograph. Now let us see the cumulative flood hydrograph. Flood hydrograph of inflow. Now here you can see on x axis time is plotted starting from the year 1957 to 65, and on y axis discharge Q in Qmax is plotted. Now this area which is hatched shows the total volume of water flown in the river up to time T1, which is 60, starting from 1957. From this flood hydrograph of inflow, mass inflow curve is constructed. Let us see mass inflow curve. Now here on the x axis time is plotted, on the y axis cumulative inflow is plotted. So this is the time, starting year is 1957 up to 65, and here you can see mass inflow in 1000 hectare meters. Now this AB is the ordinate at time T1 is equal to area of hatched portion in flood hydrograph up to time T1. Let us understand it by keeping the flood hydrograph and the mass inflow curve side by side. See here, time is plotted on x axis and mass inflow on y axis. Here also discharge is plotted on y axis, on x axis time is plotted. Now here the ordinate AB is equal to this hatched area up to time T1. Mass inflow curve is a continuously rising curve. It is a continuously rising curve. The slope of the curve represents the rate of inflow, and if it is horizontal at any particular point means there is no inflow. So these hollows, you can see here, these hollow, this is hollow, this also, they represent the dry periods. Then let us define a demand curve. A demand curve is a plot between accumulated demand with time. Demand curve may be straight line or curved. Straight line represent uniform rate of demand, curve represent variable rate of demand. Now see the two demand curves here. This is the straight line demand curve. Time is plotted on x axis. Here the accumulated demand is plotted on y axis. So it is straight line, and this is varying rate of demand, which is a curve. Again time is plotted on x axis, and then on y axis accumulated demand is plotted. After defining the demand curves and also mass inflow curve, let us calculate the reservoir capacity for a specified yield from the mass inflow curve. Here we calculate the reservoir capacity for a particular demand from mass inflow curve. Now see this here on the x axis you can see time is plotted, on the y axis accumulated inflow or cumulative inflow, you can say mass inflow. So time starting from 60 up to 65. Now demand curve is also plotted on the same with time on x and demand on y axis. It is a uniformly varying. Now this is the mass inflow curve. This is the mass inflow curve. And the ridges on the mass inflow curve denoted by the letter A2, this is A3 and this is A1. From points A1, A2, A3, draw tangents parallel to the demand curve. So here from A1, this is the tangent drawn. Then measure the intercept, vertical intercepts E1, D1. This is the vertical intercept, this is the vertical intercept, this is the vertical intercept. So the maximum of these intercepts gives the reservoir capacity. Here you can see the required reservoir capacity is equal to, out of these three vertical intercepts, E2, D2 is maximum and it is 2100 hectare meter. Now see here, E1, C1 is the demand and D1, C1 is the flow in the river available. So that means the river flow is falling short of the demand by E1, D1. So this much of storage you must get it from the reservoir. Now at the point B1, the reservoir is full and it is overflowing. So the vertical intercept between two successive tangents is called spill. That means this much of spillway capacity should be provided for allowing the water to flow downstream side. So this is the spill capacity. So this is how we calculate the storage capacity of the reservoir from the mass inflow curve for a given demand. Determination of safe yield from a reservoir of a given capacity. Now here, for a given capacity, how much quantity of water that can be supplied from a reservoir to meet the required demand is calculated. In this example, the reservoir capacity is taken as 1500 hectare meter. Look at this graph. On x axis time is plotted, on y axis mass inflow is plotted. Now see here, now this is the mass inflow curve and this is the demand curve. You can see different lines at varying rates, at starting from 1000 to 5000. Now from these ridges, this is the ridges on the mass, this is the mass inflow curve. So these are the ridge points 1, 2, 3. From the ridges, draw lines, tangents in such a way that the deviation from the mass inflow curve is equal to reservoir capacity. Now see here, so these are the vertical intercepts. Now this E1, D1, E2, D2, E3, D3 is equal to reservoir capacity. Then measure the slope of the tangents, measure the slope of the tangents, and the slope of the flattest tangent gives the safe yield from the reservoir. So out of these three, whichever is the flattest will give you the safe yield from the reservoir, and it is shown here by a thick line which is 2500. So this is how the safe yield from a reservoir of given capacity is calculated. The next one is evaporation. Evaporation is one of the important link in hydrologic cycle. Because of evaporation, the loss of water from the reservoir is around 1.6 meter in a year, and in terms of volume it is 1.6 meters multiplied by area of reservoir, which will give you the total quantity of water lost from the reservoir. So it is therefore very important to study the evaporation, and let us see the definition of evaporation. Evaporation is the process in which a liquid changes to the gaseous state at the free surface below the boiling point through the transfer of heat energy. Now let us understand the evaporation phenomena by means of a sketch. Evaporation phenomena. You can see here a pond consisting of water. The water molecules in the pond are in continuous motion at varying speed. You can see the arrows here. The up arrows represents the water molecules which are escaping the water surface, and this down arrow represents the water molecules which are penetrating the water surface. So the molecules are in constant motion. When sufficient heat energy is supplied, the molecules will try to escape out of the water surface, and similarly the molecules, vapor molecules which are above the water surface penetrate the water surface. So the net escape of molecules from liquid state to vapor state is called evaporation. So this is how the evaporation takes place on any reservoir water surface. Now let us see the factors affecting evaporation. Vapor pressure, temperature, wind speed, atmospheric pressure, quality of water, size of the water body. Vapor pressure. Vapor pressure, see here, the vapor pressure affect the evaporation according to this formula given by Dalton. This is called Dalton's equation. Here EL represents rate of evaporation in millimeters per day. It is proportional to difference of saturation pressure at the water temperature in mm and actual vapor pressure in the air in mm. So EL is proportional to EW minus EA, and evaporation continues till EW is equal to EA. Once EW exceeds EA, condensation takes place. Condensation means changing from gaseous to liquid state. That is called condensation. Temperature. Rate of evaporation increases with an increase in the water temperature. Rate of evaporation increases with an increase in the air temperature also. Wind speed. Due to wind, the vapor molecules present in the evaporation zone are carried away and giving more scope for further evaporation. The rate of evaporation increases with the wind speed. You can see here, next, atmospheric pressure. A decrease in the barometric pressure as in high altitudes increases evaporation. Barometric pressure means it is atmospheric pressure. As you know that pressure decreases as altitude increases. Quality of water. Rate of evaporation is more in case of pure water. Evaporation from sea water is about 2 to 3% less than that from fresh water. So here you can see that evaporation from reservoir surfaces is more than from sea surface. Size of water body. If the area of water body is more, evaporation is more. Deep water bodies have more heat storage than shallow ones. So, a reservoir having a cone shape is preferred because of less area and more depth. If the reservoir surface area is more, there is every chance of increase in evaporation loss. Now, next, evaporation from a water surface is estimated by the following methods. Using evaporometer data, empirical evaporation equations, analytical methods. Let us discuss in detail about evaporometers. Evaporometers are water containing pans which are exposed to the atmosphere and loss of water by evaporation measured in them at regular intervals. Now, let us understand this. Types of evaporometers. You have different types of evaporometers: class A evaporation pan, ISI standard pan, Colorado sunken pan, US Geological Survey floating pan. And let us see a picture of evaporometer. Now, see here, this is the pan made up of iron or copper, and the diameter is between 900 to 1200 and the height will is 200 to 400 mm. And this is placed over a wooden platform of height 150 mm for free circulation of air below the pan. Now, water level in this evaporometer is kept at a particular level, and in the middle you can see there is a cylinder for measuring the height of the water level by means of a hook gauge. And this is also covered with a wire mesh so that it is protected from birds. Now, this water level is reduced due to evaporation, and water is added by means of a cylindrical measure to bring back the water level to the original, and the quantity of water added is equal to the evaporation loss from the pan. So, this is how the evaporation loss is measured. Then reservoir evaporation is estimated by this formula. The water volume loss due to evaporation from a reservoir in a month is calculated as VE into A multiplied by EPM into CP. Now, where VE is equal to volume of water lost in evaporation in a month in terms of cubic meter, and A is a average reservoir area during the month in meter square. EPM means pan evaporation loss in meters in a month, which is calculated is by this EL in mm per day into number of days in a month into 10 to the power of minus 3. This 10 to the power of minus 3 is to convert that into meters, because here EL is in mm. Then CP is equal to relevant pan coefficient. So, this is the correction factor for the data obtained from evaporometers, and it depends upon the type of the evaporometer. Then methods for reduction of evaporation losses: reduction of surface area, mechanical covers, chemical films. Reduction of surface area: evaporation is directly proportional to the surface area of water body. Reduction of surface area reduces evaporation losses. Deep reservoir in place of wider reservoir are preferred. Then mechanical covers: permanent roofs over the reservoir, temporary roofs and floating roofs may be adopted wherever feasible. And the last one is chemical films. This method consists of applying a thin chemical film on the water surface to reduce evaporation, and this is the most feasible method. So, chemicals such as cetyl alcohol and stearyl alcohol are used, and these layers act as evaporation inhibitors by preventing the water molecules to escape. By this method, the reduction in evaporation is 60%. Under field conditions, 20 to 50% reduction can be achieved. Adverse effect of high wind on performance of chemical film is one of the major problem. So, this is about evaporation, and today is this topic is closed. Thank you.